Good morning. Wow, Sunday morning, hallelujah. Woo. Amen. All right. We're going to get started, and we start off with birthdays and anniversaries. Has anybody got a birthday or an anniversary? Anybody got a birthday or an anniversary? Oh, no. Yeah? Oh, God, I forgot about that. Yeah, I got a birthday coming up soon. Sure do. Oh, we're good. No, all right, everybody stand up and we're going to sing happy birthday. Hallelujah. When is it, like 13? Okay. All right. Y'all ready? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. Wow, we're a little short-handed today, but we're going to do all right. Amen. So let's get started, Gail. Come on. Oh, no. Gail, you're not ready to go. I'm sorry. We got a little somebody new in the booth, and we'll fix it up in just a second. Hold on, Gail. Put that on pause. Just let's wait. Over there. Just cut it off. All right, you got to go like this. Nobody told you about the computer screen.
Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, today, and we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today, and we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place, and we won't be quiet. We'll shout out your praise. We're gonna shout out your praise. We'll shout out your praise. We'll shout out your praise.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. You know, it doesn't matter how you feel or what you've been through or anything. We're still going to praise you. No matter what, hallelujah.
While I was sleeping, Lord, you were working on a mess I made like only I can do. When I start thinking I'm so far from you, I wake up to hear you whisper, that's not true. Good morning, mercy. You call me worthy. Feels like the sun shining on my face. Living's good this side of grace. I feel it working. Goodbye to the hurting. You woke me up, put me on my way. Hallelujah, it's a brand new day. Good morning, mercy. Trust and follow. I won't worry what tomorrow's gonna bring. Hold it all there in your hands. If you line up now, 'cause it makes me worthy. Good morning, mercy. You call me worthy. Feels like the sun shining on my face.
Everything seems to be okay again. Amen. From the last night. When things are really hard, God, just wake up that next day and everything's okay. Hallelujah.
Mm. Oh, wow.
Whew. I'm going to ask you guys to do something for me, if you would. Pray for me. We're in a place where we've got to make a lot of decisions. And it's not going to be easy. It's going to be hard, hard decisions. And it's come to that point where it's going to have to happen. And something I'd never want to see happen. Go ahead, Gail.
Thank you, Lord.
I lose the fight, try my best, but just don't get it right. Here I talk a talk that I don't want, miss the moments right before my eyes. Somebody with a hurt that I could have helped, somebody with a hand that I could have held. When I just can't see past myself, Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love, and faith. A little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. I must confess, I still need help to see the way you see. Somebody with a hurt that I could have held, somebody with a hand that I could have held. When I just can't see past myself, Lord, help me be a little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith. A little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me. Your name is the greatest. Your name
above them all. All thrones and dominions, all power and position, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. You've been forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, then sing the song forever to the Lamb. And amen, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy.
Say amen. Praise the Lord. We have people we want to pray for this morning. Miss Pat Vicente's brother passed last night, sometime in the evening. I want to pray for Pat and her family, Pat Vicente. Also, Miss Eloise McKeaton's husband, they had sent him to Charleston for cancer treatment and an operation, but they decided not to do an operation, and they sent him back to Florence to pray for her. Continue to pray for Miss Judy Foley, and we ask God today to continue to work in the life of our church. And everyone who has a need this morning, will you lift your hand to the Lord, please? We thank God today. He's mindful He knows our need before we ask him. Let me remind you also, next Sunday is our friend day. You want to invite a friend, a neighbor, someone you know to be here and worship together with us. Amen. So we're going to pray together, ask God to bless these needs. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for meeting us here today. You are holy God, Father. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We pray, Lord God, today that you would speak to our hearts. And we ask, dear Lord God, that you would give us that spiritual ear. God, we need to hear from you, Lord. And God, the ones we've mentioned, even names we didn't mention, we thank you, dear Lord God, you know the needs. And we pray, God, that you would work mightily in the lives of these people. And we just bless you because you're God. And Lord, we pray you work mightily here, Lord God, in this place. Lord God, we need you above all things, Lord. Our whole nation, we need you, Lord. And we thank you, dear Lord God, for meeting us here. And we ask, Lord God, you be glorified in this service by the power of your Holy Spirit, God. Just have your will and your way. We thank you for all things. And the church said amen. And amen. You may be seated. I need to borrow some money. It's my wife's birthday. So at least you said it is. I know it is.
Like the theme of everything that we've done today is kind of rolled into, it's together. Because in Sunday school we were talking about how God exalts us in due time. He will not look at the prideful, that he looks at those who esteem others higher than themselves. And then the songs that we sang, all of this is such a blessing. In Psalm 138, it tells us, and please go back and read the entire psalm at your leisure time. Psalm 138:6 says, though the Lord is on high, yet he regards the lowly. But the proud he knows from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you will revive me. You will stretch out your hand against the wrath of my enemies, and your right hand will save me. The Lord will perfect that which concerns me. Your mercy, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the works of your hands. And we, being created in his image, we are the works of his hands. So when we think about asking and believing in the things that we, you know, put our petitions to, the Lord will perfect that which concerns me. And so I think about this, and this was a devotion that I read this morning. There's a divine mystery in suffering. There's a strange and supernatural power that occurs in us when we suffer. And weirdly enough, people are drawn to suffering. There's something highly anointed about those who suffer. It's beyond our human reason. But God, in his view, there's never been a great saint who has not passed through great suffering. And when the suffering soul reaches a calm, sweet carelessness, that soul can say, no matter what, I trust you, Lord. No matter what it is and where it's going to take me and the path I'm going down, it can inwardly smile at its own suffering and doesn't even ask God to deliver from suffering. Then you're brought to a blessed place. And that's what draws people to those who suffer. Patience has had its perfect work. And the crucifixion weaves itself into moving away from the cross, but moving to the crown. And then we can cast them where? At his feet. Amen.
Let's stand together. Give God a good hand clap for his word this morning. Come on, let's give God a great big hand clap this morning. Amen. God is so good to us. Let's make a strong effort, if you will, to bring your friend next Sunday as we look together and worship together. It's a good opportunity that we can reach out to one another. And particularly our friends, we know people that need the Lord. I have a lot of friends that I've known a long time ago and called one the other day accidentally and was talking with him. And I know he needs the Lord. He's a good person. And he said, I'm a good person. I know I'm going to heaven. That ain't going to get it. We have to be saved. Amen. And we need to help our friends to get to the house of God, that we can hear the gospel, the power of God that saves us. Amen. If you love the Lord today, say amen. It's so good today we could gather here together. We thank the Lord for his blessing, for all God's doing among us and what God's going to do today. We're going to give back to the Lord today. As I said many times, we're never more like our Savior than when we give. And he gave it all. He gave his life. He laid it down that we could have eternal life. Amen. Let's ask God to bless our time of giving. Let's pray together.
Thank you, Lord, for perfecting what concerns each one of us. Thank you for choosing us and that we are the work of your hands. And we pray, oh God, that you would use each one of us to reach out and pull somebody up, Lord, help them out of their pit. Just remembering that we used to be there. And I pray, Father, that you would bless each family and each home that's in this congregation, and that you would use them mightily, Lord. I pray you strengthen those that are bereaved. I pray that you heal those that are sick, Lord. I pray that you help in decisions that have to be made. And that through that, Lord, you provide every need according to your riches and glory. In Christ Jesus we pray. Amen.
If you will, at this time, children and ladies and gentlemen, come quickly to worship the Lord in giving. And our children go next door for children's ministry. If you want to help in children's ministry, let us know. We have a place for you. You can help during our time of ministry to our children.
Oh, how he loves me. I've got a friend. And he is my strength. He is my portion. With me in the valley, with me in the fire, with me in the storm. Let all my life testify, hallelujah, we are not alone, God really loves us, God really loves us.
Wow, you know, I we travel a lot. Lord have mercy, we travel so much. There's probably not a day when we're not either upstate Virginia or somewhere traveling. And run across a lot of people. And you know, I had a lady come to me this weekend. We were in Virginia and we were having a bad day. And came to me and she says, you know what you got to do? What you got to do is you need to sit down and pray about this. You know, I thought to myself, I never thought about that. I pray about this every day. Every day. Go ahead. Hey, sometimes you win some, sometimes you lose some, but right now, I'm losing bad. Stood on this stage, day after day, reminding the broken that it'd be all right. To sing when there's nothing to bring you down. What will he say when I'm held to the flame like I am right now? I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand, but even if you don't, my hope say it only takes a little faith to move.
right now. God, when you choose to leave mountains unmovable, give me the strength to be able to say, it is well with my soul. I know you're able and I know you can save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope is you alone. I know the sorrow and I know the hurt would all go away. I will cling to you. Oh, come. I know you're able. And I know you can. I know you're able. And I know you can. Save through the fire with your mighty hand. But even if you don't, my hope.
Thank you, Brother Billy. Let's all stand together, will you? Amen. I want you to raise your hand if this past week there's been a lot of opposition you've been aware of, a lot of things happening in your life. Anytime that we make up our mind to seek the things of God, we need to be prepared. The Bible tells us we need to put on the whole armor of God that we're able to stand. Some things in life we can't change. But what we can change, God expects us to change. I've learned over the years of ministering and helping people, until somebody makes up their mind to change, they're just not going to change. But when they get sick and tired of being sick and tired in the situation, then they can see some changes in their life. But I do know today, without a doubt, that God can change all things. That God could take what's wore out and hurt and beat, down and out, and God can make it new and fresh if we just turn everything over to Him. Would you say amen? So we've been talking, you know, in a lot of things. We finished up in 1 John, and I've asked the Lord to guide me and lead me about today. I want to talk about the Holy Spirit. We've been seeing God moving. And I believe when God begins to move, then we see the devil begins to move. He tries to stumble us up. He tries to hinder us. He tries to direct us in the wrong way. But I want to encourage you today to keep doing what you have been doing. Keep seeking the Lord. And God will manifest Himself to you. We're going to talk today about a passion as believers that we all should have within our hearts, a passion for God the Holy Spirit in our life. Today in our life, while we're here on this planet, if we want to have a relationship with Jesus, God the Father, it's only going to be by seeking passionately the Holy Spirit in our life. God loves us and He has given us all that we need. I'm going to share a scripture, and a lot of times, and most of the time I do, what they call expository preaching right on through a book and verse by verse. But today is a topic that's about the person of the Holy Spirit. And if you look in 1 Corinthians in chapter 13, we know that's what a lot of people call the love chapter, because that we are to love the Lord and love people. And a lot of people go through the motions of saying they love, but if it's not genuine godly love, it's just a bunch of noise. Would you say amen? When we come to church, we need to pray and worship the Lord, not because everybody else is, but because we have a desire to. And we're going to come together to worship God and praise Him. You know, we can either be a slop bucket Christian or a silver platter Christian. And we want to make sure that we all, everything desire for us to be. But in chapter 14 in 1 Corinthians, and remember now, Paul is, by the inspiration of God, the Holy Spirit, the very breath of God upon him, he's writing to this very, very gifted congregation, this church in Corinth. And they were so gifted and so much going on in their life, sometimes they didn't even know how to handle the blessing of God upon their life. And so he writes in verse 14, he says, follow after charity, which he talked about in verse 13, and desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you may prophesy, and that you may speak, for if he that speaks in an unknown tongue speaks not unto men, but unto God. For no man understands him, howbeit in the spirit he speaketh mysteries. I'm reading a little bit further. But he that prophesies speaketh unto men to edification, exhortation, and comfort. He that speaketh in an unknown tongue edifies himself. But he that prophesies builds up, edifies the church. Now, I want to tell you something. The Bible tells us, as believers, that we are to preach the gospel. That word prophesy, people have taken out of context. If you want to tell something about God, let me tell you something. God's not making anything new. There's nothing new under the sun. You can do all you want and try to figure out all you want. These people think they figure things out. There's nothing new. The Word of God is all that we need today. Would you say amen? And the power of God, the Holy Spirit. So the Bible tells us, follow after love. Love people. Desire spiritual gifts, but rather that you may prophesy. You may be seated. Father, we pray, Lord God, today, by the power of your Holy Spirit, God, that you would be glorified in this place. God, this is a sanctuary where we come together, Lord God, to congregate together, to fellowship together, Lord Jesus, to praise you and lift up your holy name. And God, you said if we lift up your name, that you would draw all men unto yourself. There's not another name, another way. There's not another word, God, that we seek after, but God, you, your holy word. And we praise you and we thank you for this time. And I pray, dear Lord God, there's someone here today and they're not saved, born again by the Holy Spirit and the Holy Word. I pray, Lord God, today they would surrender their life to you, Lord Jesus, and be born again afresh and anew. Lord God, today I pray that I would not be heard, but God, I pray that you would preach this message, that, Lord God, we would learn our desire should be all about you, that we should seek you, Lord God, the power of your Holy Spirit as believers. I pray, God, you'll be glorified, and the church said amen. So as we look together, we go back and we remember throughout history, the early New Testament church, through supernatural signs, accomplished the teaching and preaching and sharing the Word of God in a powerful way. Supernatural means of forces above laws and nature happen. Mystical, unusual, extraordinary, miraculous, divine things happen. God was moving by the power of the Holy Spirit there in the early church. God has not changed. God's ways are greater than higher than our ways. We above all things today desire God's ways. Think about after the day of Pentecost, the outpouring of God the Holy Spirit. The Bible says in the book of Acts in chapter 2, in verse 43, and it says, and fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. I'm reminded about down there where Paul and Silas were in the Philippian jail, that when God began to move in the jail, prison cell, that even the jailer himself, he had fear upon his life, and he called upon them and said, "What must I do to be saved?" Fear, power, the love of God was drawing by the power of the Holy Spirit the jailer to understand and have fear in his life that he needed God. It's a crazy person not to realize that they need God, that they need salvation, that they need to be saved. Think about it. After the Pentecostal disciples and followers of Jesus become the apostles of Christ, an apostle is one sent forth, set aside, called by God the Holy Ghost, trained and commissioned by Almighty God Himself. We need the Word of God. We need God's Word in our life. We need training of the Word of God that we can go and prophesy and preach the Word of God. Could you imagine living in that time? Or could you imagine right now what the environment would be, that every time God's Holy Word was spoken, there were healings, there were miracles, signs and wonders were manifested. Can you imagine what would happen in the world today? Think what it would do for an unbeliever. Think how it would affect the church today. No wonder the Apostle Paul declared the gospel, the spoken, taught Word of God, is the power of God unto salvation. I think about being in those foreign countries when you preach the Word of God to these people who have nothing. They have nothing, no cars. Some don't have a home, no income, and you preach the Word of God and they fall down on their knees and cry out and ask God to save them. Could you imagine what would happen in America if the same power was let loose today in the churches all over the nations? People healed, signs, wonders, and miracles. Think about what would happen. Think about it. No wonder we see here Paul was overwhelmed with the Word of God. The Apostle Paul himself spoke it, and he personally experienced the Word of God. It's hard, and it's almost totally impossible to have a desire by the things of God if you don't know about the things of God. We've had hard times. We've had good times. We've had valleys. We've had mountains. We've had tragic events. We've had hurts in our life. Where was God? He was always there. God always helped us. But your friend, we must understand, there's no way that we can share the Word of God if we don't know the Word of God. We should be telling everybody. That's what it means here about prophesying. The manifestation, the power of God the Holy Spirit. Signs, wonders, and miracles took place. Everywhere these apostles and these disciples went, everywhere they spoke the Word of God never returned void. Listen, we don't need a wildfire today in the church. And we don't need a wildfire in our life. A wildfire causes damage. It causes trouble. Sometimes people get in the church and they go wild. What we need is a holy fire. Amen. A building up God's people. When we come to the house of God, we know that we've been in the presence of God. We need a passionately pursue God to set us on fire for Him. Listen, not a fire. Listen, notice here, a fire that's always left attended and ignored will eventually go out. And that's what's happened today in a lot of people's lives. They came to the house of God and the power of God began to burn in their whole, their soul, and it began to speak to the hole that they have in their life, the void of God Almighty, the need of the Lord Jesus. And they felt like they needed God and they say they got saved, but they have abandoned God. They left God. They left the house of God. They abandoned the people of God. And you wonder why the fire went out. These people have fallen away. Have you ignored God today? Have you ignored God? Has your heart grown soggy and cold and hard? I think about, friend, how hard a person can come to the things of God when you neglect the Word of God, the house of God, and the people of God. I remember in Charleston at one particular time or different times that they would do an MRI on Solomon. And they would show his heart and his liver and his body and the organs in the side of his body. And it amazed me, absolutely amazed me, that when that nurse would take that, that wand and rub over his heart that you could see on the screen. In his heart was a fire, was a flicker. Do you understand today? If your fire goes out, you're going out. See, friend, that there's a fire right now in your heart. It keeps on sparking. It keeps on sparking. If you don't believe that, friend, you go get an MRI and look on the screen, and there's a fire. There's a flame inside of you. And what we need, friend, today is we need to be on fire for God. Burning up for the Lord Jesus. We're the body of Christ. We need to be on fire for God. Are you on fire for God today? The things of life that prepare us for now and prepares us for eternity. Believers in the early church continued steadfastly in the Word of God. They continued on. You can't continue on if you focus on people. You got to focus on God. You got to keep moving forward, seeking God. They possessed an intense focus, a constant diligence, a sustained effort to learn and apply God's Word in their life. They wanted to hear the Word, and they wanted to be people who not only heard what Jesus said, but they wanted to practice the Word. Other words, they possessed a passion for the power of God, by the work of God, by the baptism of the power of God, the Holy Spirit. See, God desires more than just a little bit of you. God desires all of us. To be baptized in the Holy Spirit is that God gives all of you. That God gives all of your life. That you're completely immersed in the power of God, the Holy Spirit. As I said prior, you're not just a possessor of the Holy Spirit, but He is president in your life. He controls you and leads you in a mighty powerful way. A baptism produced within those early believers a passion for God the Holy Spirit. Listen, there's no separation from the Word of God and the Spirit of God. You cannot separate. Somebody say amen. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 14:1, follow after charity, love, desire, spiritual gifts. God says that we should be spiritual people. Desire, Greek there, it means a zelo, a word intended to imitate the sound of boiling water bubbling over, because something is so hot to burn with zeal, to be earnest, to set one's heart on, and to be completely intent upon, passionately on fire, a hot pursuit. The Bible said they had gathered together because Jesus told them to go and wait in the upper room. And the Holy Spirit, the Bible said, came like the sound of a mighty rushing wind. See, friend, we are who God wants us to be when we hear the things that God has to say. If you haven't heard from God, you don't belong to God. God speaks to us. If there's anything that's needed in our lives, in the world today, is the work of God, the Holy Spirit. That God works in us and God works among us. In our study, we're going to look at the power of the person of the work of the Holy Spirit that's necessary in the life of every believer to make you strong. Paul writes to the church over there. He says, finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord in the power of His might. God desires that we're strong in the power that He gives us. So in order to be a successful believer, we need a passion for the person and the work of God the Holy Spirit. And God the Holy Spirit is not an it. He's a third person in the Holy Trinity. Don't make Him any less than God. He's the breath of God. He's the hand of God. He's the power of God. And we need power in our life every day, particularly in a dark and sinful world which we live in today. Therefore, God, we said, we desire, as God said, He desires the operation of His gifts in our life, our church, our community, just as it happened in the early church. Notice here, Jesus and the Holy Spirit are inseparable. You can't separate one from the other. We must always remember God the Father gave God the Son, and God the Son gave us the Holy Spirit. He shared himself with us by the power of the Holy Spirit who works inside of us. I tell you, when you begin to hear from God, you're hearing the voice of the Holy Spirit. He's ministering to you. He's guiding you. He's helping you. He's leading you. He's teaching you because he's God's breath. The Bible said in Colossians 1:19, "For it pleased the Father that in Jesus that all fullness dwell." When you sing Jesus, you sing God the Father. When you sing Jesus, you sing God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Within him. Think about God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Again, Paul says, listen, that we as believers follow after love and desire a spiritual gift, but rather that you may prophesy. How many times over the years that I've stood here in this pulpit and said, at least in one year, 365 days, you should at least bring one person to Christ. Bring them to the house of God. God has given us multiple ways of transportation. Friend, we should be doing something. A good indication that you filled with the Spirit of God is you bringing people to God. You're prophesying. You're doing the work that God has called us to do. We should be filled with the Holy Spirit. So we see the believer in the first century church had a passion for the Holy Spirit and power for experiencing the gifts at work among them. God wants to work among you. It was actually an outpouring, a revelation, a manifestation of God's work. God desires to work within us. And God desires to work through us. The Bible said, Acts chapter 2 and verse 17. The Bible said, "It shall come to pass in the last days, said God, I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy." That means preach. "And your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams." Have you ever had a vision from God? Have you had a dream from God? I had a dream from God when I was in the penitentiary. You know, God, sometimes I had to put you somewhere where you just shut up and let God talk to you. I'm telling you, it might be bankruptcy, divorce. It might be the hospital. It might be in a prison. It might be an emergency room. God has a tendency and a way of putting you in a place where you can't do nothing but shut up and look up. Somebody say amen. A mighty dream. And I will tell you something. God will speak to you. God will gift you. And the devil will do everything he can to keep you from exercising that gift. Why you say that, preacher? Because the Bible said in John 10:10, the thief, he comes to kill, steal, and destroy. He's stealing from church people every day. The privilege of preaching, proclaiming the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. God said, "I've come that you may have life, an abundant life." We should be prophesying, preaching the word of God everywhere that we go. The Bible said in Acts chapter 4, in verse 13 and 14, very clearly here in the scripture, talks about Peter and John, that they had went up to the temple. They were unlearned and ignorant people. They thought they were crazy. They marveled and took knowledge of them that had been with Jesus. And behold, the men which were healed standing with them could not say anything against them. Let me tell you something. Don't be surprised who you'll see get saved if you will proclaim and prophesy what Jesus said in the Word of God. Don't be surprised that God heals somebody, that you have faith in the name of Jesus, that God will heal their body. God's still healing people. If you don't believe it, stay sick. God will heal you. God is a healer, and God is keeping on healing. The prayer of John and Peter there, they says in the scripture about this man who sat there every day at the front door of the church in chapter 4 and verse 29. Look what they pray and ask God for in the scripture in chapter 4 verse 29. "And now, Lord, behold, they're threatening. They came against him. Grant thy servant that with all boldness they may speak your word." Are we lacking boldness? wonder why we don't share Jesus. Maybe we are empty and void. Don't have the Holy Spirit of God leading and guiding and controlling our lives. You can't tell me that you're saved and you haven't encountered people that God didn't say, well, what about their soul? What about that person? And see, friend, if that person looks different than you and you think you're better than them, you ought to get saved. Because, see, we have a deep understanding. If God saved you, He'll save anybody. He'll save anybody if He saved us. Amen. God's working, He said, by stretching forth thy hand to heal, and the signs and wonders may be done by the name of the Holy Child Jesus. They prayed. Have you asked God to fill you with the Spirit, God, and help me, Lord Jesus, empower me that I can tell somebody about your amazing and loving grace? God uses servants mightily. Yet listen, let no one on earth know the Holy Spirit better and more intently than the Lord Jesus Christ Himself. Jesus and the Holy Spirit were completely connected from beginning, before anything was anything, to the beginning of His life, His earthly ministry throughout the end of His life on the earth, and His resurrection. Jesus was forever inseparable, always connected with the person and the power of God the Holy Spirit. There's churches today that try to separate the Holy Trinity. You go to some high churches and all they want to talk about is God. You go to some churches, they say, we just Jesus. Friend, if you're a Christian, it's God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Ghost. It'd be like buying a car with no gas. Who wants a car with no gas? It'd be like buying a car with no wheels. You ain't going to have no power. And see, friend, our commission, our passion is to say, dear God, this morning I'm going out in a lost world. And God, light me up before I leave the house. God, fill me up with your Spirit that I can find somebody I can preach to and tell them about the love of God Almighty. If God hadn't done anything in your life, you ain't got nothing to say. Before Christ's final ascension into heaven, Jesus promised the baptism in the Holy Spirit to His disciples. You know, we talk about the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and some churches just say, oh, you charismatic. Charismatic is a good word. I'd rather be a charismatic than dead. All over the country today, at 12 o'clock, the clock has struck 12 dead. People rather get there and hear a little sermonette from a Christian net, go outside and smoke a cigarette, and think they've been in the presence of God. Friend, I'm going to tell you something. God is a holy God, and we've got to empty ourselves so God can fill us with His Holy Spirit. Somebody say amen. The Bible said, but you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be a witness unto me in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, to the uttermost parts of the earth. Now, who is that scripture for? It ain't for the maces, mooses, and gooses and all these things. That's for the believer. God said, when you get saved, when you get filled with the Holy Spirit of God, you're going to be a witness from me everywhere you go. No matter where it's in your house, no matter where it's in your town, no matter if you're on vacation, no matter if you're on the other side of the world, you should be a witness. My wife went to China some time back and she smuggled some Bibles over. Carried the Word of God over there for somebody to have. And they warned them, no, don't bring the Bible. Don't you get in trouble over here. Well, praise God today, maybe somebody has the Word of God. We got to go everywhere telling everybody about the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen, these were Jesus' last words to them. Once at the Father's right hand, the Bible said Jesus went up and He went to the Father's right hand where He forever makes intercession for us. He's praying for us today. He's praying for you. He's praying for me. That Bible says in Acts chapter 2, verse 33, therefore being by the right hand of God exalted, having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, He has shed forth this which you now see and you hear. Let me tell you something, friend. Jesus is the Father, the Son. He's the power of the Holy Spirit. And God is with him. And God has always been beside him and in him because he's God. Jesus, the Bible said, shed forth or poured out the Holy Spirit upon them. Not only was the Holy Spirit upon them, the Holy Spirit was in them. Let me tell you something. If you're not careful, you let that fire go out, all you're going to be is a puff of smoke. God desires that we be on fire for him. That scripture in John chapter 14 and 16, Jesus said, don't let your heart be troubled. I'm going to send you a comforter. I'm not going to leave you alone. God has given us the Holy Spirit. This was the first act of Jesus after taking his rightful place with the Father. Everything Jesus did was a partnership with the Holy Spirit. At church, should we expect to be successful if we do anything less? How can we walk? How can we be? How can God use us apart from partnering up with God the Holy Spirit? The church today is not filled with people who claim to be saved because they are not partners with God the Holy Spirit. You say, I woke up this morning, I felt like I ought to go to church. That was absolutely none of you. That was the Holy Spirit. Because you and I say, well, man, I ain't never had the bed feel so good in all my life. I'm just going to lay here and wallow in a bed all day long. How sick and how sad would somebody stand up and even say they know Jesus and have no conviction to come to the house of God, praise him and give him glory. Church, should we expect any less than what Jesus gave to us as an example? I didn't put all these scriptures down for the person in the sound booth, but listen very carefully. Matthew 1:20, Jesus was conceived by the Holy Spirit in the womb of a virgin. Never known a man. Matthew 3:16, Jesus was baptized by the Holy Spirit at the River Jordan. Not did he need to receive the baptism, but it did it for our example. That we need to be filled and baptized. We need to be consumed by the Holy Spirit. Luke 4 and 14, Jesus was led by the Spirit before doing and after his testing, why that yet he was there in the wilderness. He was filled with the Spirit. Every time he spoke by the power of God the Holy Spirit. Luke 4, 18, 19, Jesus was empowered to minister by the power of the Holy Spirit. You can't separate God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Everything he did, I said before, was God's hand. It was the power of God Almighty. Matthew 12, 28, Jesus cast out demons by the power of God the Holy Spirit. You know, we see these crazy, spooky, scary, dark, demonic television program movies, and we think people who are possessed by evil spirits that they're doing crazy things and flying around in the room and floating around in there. Let me tell you something. Our world is filled with people full of demonic spirits. I'm telling you right now, being led by darkness, the devil himself, they're calling God a liar. The Bible says in John chapter 14 and 16 that Jesus talked about the Holy Spirit. Hebrews 9:14. Jesus, listen, he offered himself up and was crucified in the power of God the Holy Spirit. He said, don't you worry about it. I got power to lay my life down. I got power to take it up again. Come on now, church. We got to understand here that God has given us life. Death has no hold on the believer. I was sharing with Miss Pat this morning. She was talking about a brother. He'd passed away and he was a believer. Let me tell you something. It's like God said to me that God has a ticket, that God has a way that every person one day is going to die. And as a believer, he's going to give you that ticket and God's going to get you home and nobody can separate you from the love of God. God knows it. You don't know it, but you better be ready because God's coming. And one day we're going to see the Lord. I like what the Bible says as Paul was writing in Romans chapter 8 and verse 11. If you love the word, say amen. But the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you. He that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwelleth in you. I tell you, your body is a temple of God the Holy Spirit. The Bible says the Holy Spirit quicken you. You know what that means? You were laying dead on the slab in the emergency room. Dead. I'm talking about graveyard dead. And there came Jesus by the power of the Holy Spirit. And he touched you. And he quickened you. And he woke you up. And you who were dead is dead no more. Amen. He's a new creature in Christ Jesus. I'm telling you, dead people everywhere. Not just on television. Walking dead everywhere you look. People are dead. People even come to church who are dead. And they need to be raised up by God the Holy Spirit. Somebody ought to shout and say amen. I like what Paul was writing into the church of Ephesus in chapter 5 and verse 17. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understand what the will of the Lord is. What's God's will? It says in verse 18, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Now, I'm not preaching something today just to be preaching it and making me feel good about being who I am today. I'm glad to be in church. I'd rather be in church than be in jail, hadn't you? Come on. Come on now. Ain't it good to be in the house of God? I tell you, I want to talk to everybody who claims to be a member of this church. You ought to be at church. You ought to be in the house of God. You ought to be here listening to that crazy spitting preacher. I'm going to tell you something. If the preacher ain't spitting, he ain't preaching. Come on now. I didn't come to church to hear a sermonette. If it don't get me excited, I don't believe it's going to get you excited. If we be excited, we should be excited by God. Not to be excited just to feel good, to be excited for the truth. For the truth of the Word of God. I tell you, God is so good. Think about it here, church. Listen, the disciples, they mirrored their master. They looked just like Jesus. They were learners. They imitated the Lord Jesus Christ. They were completely submitted to their master and would do anything their master requested. They followed him. They followed him. You say, well, you know, you probably stand up like everybody would. We all would probably stand up and say, well, I'm never going to quench the Holy Spirit. You're a liar. We all are liars, what the Bible says. So how many times have we been in the community? And how many times have we been in the storefronts and places and God began to speak to you about the concern about the people around you? And we would say, well, I just don't think it's a good time. And, you know, that person don't look like me. I don't think I need to tell them. Friend, you've quenched the Holy Ghost of God. You put the fire out and you ain't worth nothing but a puff of smoke. We got to keep the fire burning. Keep the fire burning. Keep the fire burning. I knew a man named Bobby Huggins who lived in Dillon. Everybody said, oh, there comes Bobby Huggins. All he's going to talk about is Jesus. Thank God for Bobby Huggins. Thank God for people who are on fire for God. Thank God for people who have their gears right. And the most important thing is put it in overdrive. The power of God, the Holy Spirit. The Bible said we don't even belong to ourselves. We need to be controlled by God. They duplicated whatever their master did. They disciples, they watched Jesus. They walked with Jesus. They ministered with Jesus. And I want to tell you something. They spent 3 years with Jesus. Some of y'all couldn't come to church but twice a month. 3 years with Jesus? Could you imagine? Every day, 3 years with Jesus. Let me tell you something. The church, we need more Jesus. We need more Word. If you're through learning, you're through. Don't you think you got it figured out because you don't. God, as we sang, His mercies are new and fresh every day. And I don't know about you, but I need Him every day. They saw Jesus, His total dependence on the work of the Holy Spirit. He said, I do what the Father tells me. The mouth of our God Almighty is the Holy Spirit. Once Jesus ascended into heaven, the 12 disciples became those apostles ministering in full force. They did what Jesus did. They ministered in the power of God the Holy Spirit. They preached the Word of God in the power of the Holy Spirit. They healed the sick in the power of the Holy Spirit. They had a passion for God the Holy Spirit. They were in partnership with the Holy Spirit. These apostles understood they could do nothing apart from the power of God the Holy Spirit. The Bible again tells us in that scripture in Acts chapter 3 that Peter and John, when they went and they did what they did, they raised up the man who was lame there before the church, and they said, "Oh, alms." They said, "We ain't got no money. Silver and gold have I none, but what I have I give unto you in the name of the Lord Jesus. Get up, walk." I like what the Holy Spirit revealed. They stretched out their right hand and they helped him get up. Sometimes we won't even drive by and pick somebody up to come to church. We have a friend's day because the preacher's trying to motivate the church to bring somebody to church. Let me tell you something. Evangelism is a beggar. Now, we've all been beggars. And we found bread at the house of God. And because we found bread at the house of God, we go and get somebody and bring them and tell them, "Here is where we found bread." People today are starving, sick, money hungry, trying to be worldly, not being anything for the glory of God. They had an addiction. I don't want to use the word addiction. I think they had a love for the power of the Holy Spirit. Interestingly, the Holy Spirit is mentioned 56 times in the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. 57 times in the book of Acts. 112 times in Paul's letters. Totally depends upon the Holy Spirit. 36 times in the remaining books of the New Testament. 261 times the Holy Spirit is ministering the gospel of grace in the New Testament. Think how vital it is to possess the power of God, the Holy Spirit, in our life. In our life. This is how that we're able to have a strong life. When Paul said, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might." Paul said in Philippians 4:13, "I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me by the Holy Spirit." Philippians 4:19, "My God shall supply all your needs according to His riches in glory by Christ Jesus, by the power of God the Holy Spirit." Paul came to a point in his life in Philippians 1:21, "For me to live is Christ and to die is gain." Assurance by the power of God the Holy Spirit. He had faith. He had opposition. Everywhere he went, everybody was out to get him. He didn't have fear. He had faith. That's strong living. That's strong living. Listen to the Word of God. I want you to stay on your feet right quick. Stand up with me, please. Listen to the Word of God. Romans 5:5, "And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God, the Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Holy Spirit is love." You can't have the rest of them if you first don't have the love of God. Would you say amen? "And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God, the Holy Ghost, the fruit of the Spirit is shed, poured out abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us," listen now, "by Jesus Christ as a gift." Everything that you have in your life to live a victorious life, to live an overcoming life, to live victory, to live the abundant life, God gives it to you. It's a gift from God. God gives us the power of the Holy Spirit. By the outpouring and the filling of God, the Holy Ghost, we're not afraid. We're not ashamed. We are anointed. And we feel bubbling over on fire and boiling over, listen, on a passionate pursuit from God, the Holy Ghost. Today in your life, you need to do all you can to ask, "Lord Jesus, fill me. God baptize me. God anoint me. God give me joy. Give me freedom. There's some of you here today and your life is tore up. God can restore you by the power and the gift of God the Holy Spirit. And this should be our prayer in the name of Jesus. The Bible says in the book of the Hebrews that now as believers, by the power and the anointing and the assurance and the confidence that God has placed in our life, we can come boldly to the throne of grace and mercy, and we can find help in our time of need. I so often wonder how many people come to church in need and go home and they still in need. When you come to God, God will provide your need. God will take care of your need. God will help you. God will make you happy. God will make you stand when everybody is trying to knock you down. God will love you when nobody else will love you. God will provide for you when you do all you can and it still ain't enough. God will send the camels. God will take care of you. Do we love God enough today to serve Him as long as we got breath? Have we got enough faith today to die for the Lord Jesus? Some folks say we got enough to live, but do we have enough to die? I'm talking about moving out your desires, your ways, your habits. Do we love the Lord enough that we put God first? Let me tell you about the church. Jesus died for it. He's coming back for it. Can your life, does your life identify with the church? As I talked to Sister Pat this morning about her brother, I asked her where he attended church. She said he was a believer. And great, thank God today, she said, he attended so-and-so church. He was a part of the body of Christ. It's something to say that you know the Lord. It's a sad thing to say there's nothing you're doing to identify with Christianity. People greedy, selfish, put the first, the self before God Almighty. We got to give it all to Him. Why you say that, preacher? Because He gave it all to us. God desires above all things that your life is full of the Holy Spirit. Every head bowed and every eye closed for just a moment. If there's someone here this morning and you're not saved, let me tell you something. God loves you. And the Bible says we come to the Father as the Spirit of God draws us. You're here today and you need to be saved. Will you come quickly and give your life to the Lord? God is calling. You need to come. And God is not going to continue calling. But thank God He's calling today. Today is the day of salvation. If there's someone watching and you need to be saved today, I pray God the Holy Spirit will break your heart like a sawed-off shotgun. Break you down to help you to realize ain't nothing you can do to help yourself unless you cast all your cares on Him. God cares for you. We're going to have a song of invitation. Are you saved? Are you hurting? Do you have a need today, a fresh touch from God, God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Is your life full, controlled by God? Or are you doing your thing or doing God's thing? You know, the Bible says that we to examine our own self. Examine your own self today. I can't judge you. You can't judge me. I know what I need to do. You know what you need to do. And do it quickly. Do it quickly for the glory of God as we have this song of invitation. You come as God leads you. Come quickly. Don't miss the Lord because you worried about what somebody thinks about you. If you need God today to do something, you come and let God work in your life. Come quickly as we have this song of invitation. Come quickly. You know somebody who's not saved, you can pray for them.
Every day they pass me by, I can see it in their eyes. Empty people filled with care, headed who knows where.
Jesus spent his time with sinners, help people,
on they go,
heal people, deliver people,
through private pain,
save people,
living fear to fear. Laughter hides their silent cries that only Jesus hears. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the end of broken dreams, he's the open door. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. When will we realize that people need the Lord? We are called to take his light to a world where wrong seems right. What would be too great a cost to share life with one who's lost? Through his love, our heart can feel all the grief must hear the words of life that only we can share. People need the Lord. People need the Lord. At the who need the Lord.
You know, all people, everywhere,
they need the
come over here, Billy, if you will, right here. I want you to sit right there, brother. We're going to pray for you today. I've often said about Billy, if he could grab a hold of the side of the building, I bet he could pick it up. He's strong. Strong man, physically. But what I've seen
is how strong a heart he has. What he's given up in order to take care of his wife. Quit his job, trusted God, God to provide for him. Thank God for this brother here. Good example. Won't you extend your hand this way? Won't you extend your hand this way? We're going to pray for our brother today. You got to help him. He never gets a break. Day or night, he's taking care of his wife. We pray God to strengthen him today. We pray God to strengthen and help him. Bill, I'm going to anoint you, brother. Father, I thank you for my brother. Such a blessing that you've gifted him to sing, Lord. But such a blessing, God, that you've given him a strong heart, a real heart, man of God. Lord, help him, Lord. He needs help. I pray by your Holy Spirit, God, you'd fill him up. He would overflow, Lord Jesus. And Father God, I pray, Lord, and thank you, Lord Jesus, that you have given him what he needs, and you will continue to do that. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for his love for you, love for his wife, love for this ministry. We thank you for it, Lord. Lord, we just give you all the glory. And we just pray you will bless him and strengthen him. We pray it in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's children said amen and amen. Give God a great big hand clap of praise, will you? Amen. You know, God has opened a door here for anybody from anywhere. If they begin to have Martians from Mars, we'll take some Martians. Amen. We'll get them in here and get them right with the Lord. God opens the door for you. But there was a time when God shut a door. Noah preached and preached and preached and preached and preached and preached. And the only people who were saved, 8 people. And the rest of the world condemned. Think about it now. If God shuts that door, it's too late. But the door's open. The door's open. If you don't know the Lord today, open up your heart. He's knocking, and let the Lord come in. Amen. I love you. God bless you. Hope you can get back on Wednesday. Please come back and be with us on Wednesday night. We got some food next door? Okay. Goodbye, please, and get that food next door and take it home with you. Hope it helps you a lot. Next Sunday, Friend Day now. Bring your friend with you next Sunday. God bless you. God bless you.